There are basically two types of devices that we utilize. One we call an external device, and one we call an internal device. I'll start with the internal devices. They're basically small little, actually, jack screws that when we create a fracture across a bone, we put that device across the fracture site on either side. And then there's a little arm that extends out, and usually that sticks out percutaneously somewhere. And when we twist that little arm with a screw, with a screwdriver head, it activates the little jack screw and it separates the fracture site. And we call that internal distraction. We use that commonly on the mandible because the mandible applies itself very nicely to internal distraction. The other type of distraction that we use, particularly for the upper face, for the mid face, for the upper jaw, and for the orbits, is what we call external device. And I'll show you that right now. And this is a pretty good looking contraption, but we'll show you how this works. If we need to move the whole face forward, you know, how are we going to do that? Using just an internal device on one side or maybe the other side is pretty hard to do. We want to have good control over the entire facial structure or the entire facial skeleton. So we actually use what we call a halo device. It's also known as a RED device. This stands for rigid external distraction, but it's a modified halo. The halo is attached to the cranium, and it's attached by pins here, and these are actually scalp pins. These pins are not bone pins. They do not go into the bone. They just push on the scalp and rest on the top of the bone. But when we put these in on both sides, that anchors this halo in place and gives it a lot of strength so that it won't move. Now we have a stable anchorage here. Then we'll go in through surgery, make our different osteotomies or bone cuts. And again, it's going to depend on what the patient needs. Upper face, lower face, combination. Then at that point with the osteotomized bone or the bone that we fractured, we then apply some type of fixation device onto that. And we show here pins, these pins that actually go into the bone now and come out percutaneously through the skin here and here. Or for the lower face, we have an orthodontic appliance like a retainer that's attached to the teeth. These little bars are attached to the appliance. They come out and around the lip, so that we can attach that to these. And then through wires, we run from our bony anchorage points to our stable halo, and the jack screws are at the end of the stable halo, so now we can turn these jack screws and move the facial bones. And the appliance allows us to move these facial bones in any direction that we want. There's a lot of versatility in this system. We can move these bars up and down. We can turn them from side to side. These can rotate, this can expand and open. So depending on the patient and the patient's requirements, we can move the face forward, downwards, a little bit to the left, a little bit to the right. So whatever the patient needs in their treatment. So again, stable anchorage point here, osteotomized facial bones here, distraction device hooked up here. We turn these, pull on the face, pull on different portions of the bones. And again, through that phenomenon of distraction, the patient grows their own bone, lays on their own bone. Now, so how does that all work again? And very simple, we put these at the end, make a turn, and that's it. We've just now moved this portion of the face forward about 0.5 millimeter. Turning the device, who does that? Well, the parents do it. So it's actually kind of a fun thing. So the parents are very interactive in their own child's care. We show them how to do it, we set everything up, and then we give them this screwdriver literally, something just like this. It's a very simple hex head. Plays it to the end. It's pretty much foolproof, tells you which way to turn. It also makes a little clicking noise. And there's also little spots on here so you can see how much to turn. One full revolution of this particular screwdriver is 0.5 millimeter, and typically the distraction rate for most patients is approximately 1 millimeter a day. So we usually have the parents turn once at night, 0.5 millimeter, and then once in the morning, another 0.5 millimeter, for about 1 millimeter per day. It's pain-free because that's such a little bit of movement that the patient can't feel that, but it's enough to just open that fracture site that we created so the body, again, sees that fracture, lays down new bone. Next day, we turn this, pulls forward gently. Oh my gosh, another fracture, lays down new bone, and we do, that's how we work. The beauty of this is totally adjustable. We can adjust this up and down. We can go sideways. We can tilt up and down. So depending on what type of level of distraction that we want or where we want to move the facial bones, vertical position, horizontal position, what we call the yaw position from side to side, we can make all those adjustments here, which we do, and then have the parents do the distraction themselves. Most patients typically will require about maybe 20 millimeters of distraction or so, 15 to 20 millimeters. So if we go a millimeter per day, that's about 15 or 20 days. So in about a 2 to 3 week time interval, the parents can actually transform the faces of their own child right before their very eyes. There are a number of different types of patients where distraction is very beneficial. We'll start with the mandible very briefly. With internal distractions, when we usually use that on the mandible, children that are born with really small mandibles that have airway issues, and we'll discuss that on another topic as well. That's a great indication. For the external distraction, cleft patients who have severe growth deformities of the upper jaw, that's actually how we started with external distraction, was applying it to cleft patients that had surgery, had lip palatal surgery, had bone grafting to their alveolus, but then didn't grow. And that's very common in patients with cleft lip and palate. And in severe patients where we have to move a jawbone, in particular the upper jaw for cleft patients, a large distance, it was difficult with the old techniques. Distraction was perfect for that. So when we move the upper jaw forward a great distance, more than 8 to 10 or 12 millimeters, distraction is a great indication. Another very important indication for external distraction is what we call mid-face distraction. That's when we need to move forward the forehead region, the eye region, the cheekbone region, the nasal region, and the upper jaw region as well. And we can do that through a number of different techniques, a number of different bone cuts, so to speak. But distraction has been a really phenomenal application in those patients for a number of reasons. And one of the big reasons is that's a very risky surgery in terms of post-operative infection. Risky enough that a lot of centers without distraction had actually banned that technique or certain techniques because the complication rate was just too high. With the distraction, because we're just moving the bones very slowly, we don't create a lot of open space in the nose and in the brain cavity, that very slow movement can heal very quickly. It prevents infections and complications from occurring. So that's really, that's almost a necessary requirement for today's work and for those patients. So that's been a very special thing.